connected to. LALIS is math withdrawal.
Hello and welcome. I am Lilius White, coming to you from the nation of Harlem in New York City. And it's the land of Black American culture, history, and beauty. I am a founding member of Black Theater United. And on behalf of all of the founders and allies, I'd like to thank all of the BTU members and allies for joining us today. These last 2 years have been difficult for theater professionals, and many in our community were left struggling financially. Now that Broadway has officially announced its reopening, along with theaters all over the country, we want to make sure that as we begin to work again, we are focused on the business and not just the show. Tonight's town hall is called Mind Your Business. And our guest, Ginger McKnight-Chavers, is here to guide us through a law and business boot camp for theater professionals. Ginger McKnight-Chavers is an author and attorney whose debut novel, In the Heart of Texas, put out by She Writes Press, won the 2016 USA Best Book Award in the category of African American Fiction. An excerpt from her novel in progress, Oak Cliff, appears in the summer 2019 issue of Solstice as a finalist in their annual literary contest. A native Texan, McKnight-Chavers is a graduate of Georgetown University and Harvard Law School. She was a Catherine Gerfine Writing Fellow at Sarah Lawrence College and is the chairman of the Sarah Lawrence College's writing program. We are happy to welcome you, Ginger. Thank you so much for being here and taking time out of your busy schedule to educate us all on how to better live and work in this business of show. Thank you all for being here. I offer to you the floor, Ginger McKnight-Chavers.
Thank you, Lilius. Thank you for that nice introduction. And thank you all for having me. Though I have spent a lot of time writing in recent years, I spent close to two decades as a full-time practicing lawyer, both in the area of corporate law and in the area of arts and entertainment. And I found that I have created my own creative projects, as well as advised other creative people, there's an overwhelming amount of information and fear out there, and fear of everything that impacts what you do and what you create. So in speaking to some of the folks I know at BTU, I thought maybe because I do teach this class at Sarah Lawrence and I'd give this lecture for other groups, an overview of some of the law and business aspects that impact your making your art, your career, might be helpful. It might also really confuse you and scare you even more, but actually I think that you'll hopefully come away, you will have an opportunity to have some to ask questions, and hopefully you'll just come away with just a little more information so that you will be able to navigate your career and ask the right questions and at least know what information you may need or help you may need to get. This topic, for the time that we have, is so expansive. I could talk just about a contract to hire an actor for a production for 45 minutes. But we're going to touch on aspects of copyright, contracts, corporate law in terms of should you create an entity for yourself? should do, entities that you create in order to put on a production, guilds and unions. There's so many things to cover. Again, this will be a broad strokes overview. But first I want to start out spending a little bit of time, maybe giving you a little bit of a 15, for those of you who haven't been to law school, giving you maybe a 15 to 20 minute law school lecture on copyright basics. The reason being, just in terms of what you do in the arts and entertainment arena, whether you're a playwright or a songwriter or a producer or a choreographer or a filmmaker, everything that you create, the law that relates to it is based in the law of copyright. Regardless of what you do in this profession, most contracts you sign are going to relate in some way to to copyright. And also, if you're a performer, an actor, a singer, a musician, you participate in the creation of works that are protected by copyright. And at some point, I mean, creativity begets creativity. And you may want to create the songs that you want to sing or write the plays that you want to, or in films that you want to appear in. Or just that you want to see in general. You will probably, if you don't already, expand your creative horizons because that's what you do as a creative person. And as your lawyer for the next hour and a half, I would tell you that actually also helps you in terms of the more ownership, literally, you can take in your creative life and in what you produce, the better. But I'm going to give you that lecture just because most people hear about, like, how do I get a copyright or how do I copy my work? But you don't really fully necessarily understand what that means. And you'll probably be glad after listening to me that you didn't go to law school and listen to that uncle who told you to go to law school and not pursue your creative career. But as someone who did listen to my uncle, I hope that I can share briefly with what I learned and what I sat through for 3 years. Okay, first, like, your great idea. Can you own an idea? The answer is no. But there's generally, if I make a declarative statement or any lawyer makes a declarative statement, there is a but involved. There's an exception. And it's navigating those exceptions that actually keep me in business. But generally, no, you can't really own an idea. And I'll tell you what I mean. Let's say, because I'm sure you hear this all the time. You know what would make a great movie? You know what would make a great play? I think that a movie about an orphan who is raised by his family members who are really mean to him, and they keep him in a little closet underneath the stairs. But that kid finds out that he's a wizard and then he's going to be called on to save the world. I think that would be a great movie. Someone saying that, isn't that a great idea? That doesn't create an ownership right in that idea. You can create an ownership right in that idea. How do you protect that idea? And how do you create an ownership right in it? You do the damn thing. You do what the copyright law tells you to do, which is take that great creative idea that you had and you fix it in a tangible medium. That's what the statute says. Well, what does that mean? That means that you take that idea and you type out that story on your computer. You write it down on paper. If you pick up a video camera or your phone and you record it. You pick up a paintbrush and you write a painting inspired by that. Inspired by that idea. Take that idea and you fix it into something tangible, and then it becomes something that you can own. The second but is that sometimes you can protect ideas by a contract. For example, it doesn't apply so much in the arts and entertainment world anymore. I'm sure that I could come up with examples, but particularly like back when people would go in and pitch ideas at studios. But it definitely in the corporate realm for things that are protected by intellectual property, if someone has a business idea, if someone goes into a company that they hope will help possibly invest in their idea, they'll usually sign some sort of confidentiality agreement that says, I'm going to come in and discuss this thing with you, see if you're interested in participating in it. When I leave here, you're not going to take that idea and then just run with it without my consent and without paying me for the idea that I brought to you. So that contract is one way to protect an idea. But generally what we're talking about in this context, you come up with a great idea for a story. You are protecting, the way you protect that idea is by creating something tangible out of that idea. And that's how that gives rise to copyright. Where people are confused is, you know, what it means to have a copyright. And there's our little C in the circle. You've usually seen that with a date and the name of the creator of something. That's really just a notice that that something that you're looking at is protected by copyright. We can go to the next screen. What is a copyright? Copyright is not a thing that you go and ask, you know, and you apply for, or you actually create a copyright right just by virtue of creating a creative work. Just by writing that play, even if you put it in a drawer and do nothing with it, you've created a copyright right in that work just by virtue of creating it. Copyright law has changed, but right now in the universe where we are today and where we've been for many years, just by creating a work, you own the copyright in it by virtue of doing that. So what is a copyright? It's an intangible thing. It's the reason why we call copyrights, patents, and trademarks intellectual property. What they're giving you is not a physical, it's not a physical thing like my Fitbit on my wrist. Though you own it in the same way I own this Fitbit on my wrist. It's a bundle of rights. The copyright that you own gives you the right to do things with that work that you created. What do I mean by that? You can make copies of it, reproduce it. You can distribute copies of it. You can perform your work publicly. You can display your work if it's a work of visual art. And you can make derivative works based on your work. I'll explain what that is. Copyright is what gives you the right to control what happens to that work that you created, that play, that film. That script. And I'll give you a little bit, just even though it sounds arcane, why do we even have this? You can probably understand it a little better if you know where the copyright right came from. It's actually in the Constitution. And someone along the way embedded in the Constitution, they gave Congress the right to give the creator of a piece of a creative work, a scientific invention, or even a business idea that you've created, certain rights to basically have a monopoly on that thing that you created for a certain amount of time. When you create a work of art, you have a monopoly on that work for a certain period of time, because they want people to invest in creativity and innovation. And people would not do that if the minute you spend maybe 5 years writing a manuscript, if someone could pick it up the next day and sell it and distribute it and to the public and make money off of what you spent years creating. This gives you the right to do that for an extended period of time. So in those rights, again, the J.K. Rowling had about the boy underneath the stairs. She wrote the original manuscript. So she had the sole right to reproduce it, meaning have it printed in books and distribute it through bookstores. Then to make derivative works based on it. When we say derivative works, those are other creative works based on an original work. So every new book in the series, the Harry Potter series, every film based, every script written based on every book in that series, each one of those is a derivative work. Every film based on every script, based on every book, is a derivative work based on that series. So it gives you a stream of rights that you own, that you yourself own, that you can use, or you can give other people the right to use. So it's really giving you the rights to do things with your work, as opposed to what I tell people, like a way to visualize it is if a painter paints a painting, I can buy that painting and hang it on my wall, but I can't reproduce it. I can't make posters of it. I can't sell postcards with the image down in Soho in New York. Those rights all remain with the creator of that work because of the copyright law. How does a copyright, let me look and see if I can see that. Okay, this is perfect. How does a copyright differ from a trademark or a patent? Copyright covers really creative works and works of art, paintings, books, films, choreographic works, music, both sound recordings and musical compositions, films, etc. Trademark is a little different. It covers brand names and logos, so things that identify products in commerce. So things like Spam or Tiffany Blue is actually protected by trademark. A trademark, when you come up with something distinctive that identifies something you're selling or a service you're giving, that's something you actually have to apply to get trademark protection. And if you're granted it, you have the sole right to sell that product using that name or logo for as long as you're selling it. Copyright, though, and patents have a lifespan. Patents cover scientific inventions, and they last for 20 years. Your copyright, though, and you can go to the next slide, lasts longer. A copyright lasts for your entire life. Your monopoly lasts for your entire life plus 70 years, meaning it's a right that you can pass on to your heirs. You can put it in your will and pass it on to whoever, those rights to whoever you want. So how do you get it? How do you get it? I said that you create it just by virtue of creating a work, you own the copyright in that work. But I know there's a copyright office in Washington. They do something. What you do with the copyright office is you register your work with the copyright office. It's a very simple process. The reason why you do it, they're twofold. One, it provides a public notice that you own this work and you own that monopoly, and if anyone wants to do anything with that work, they have to come to you, because you feel, basically it's a very simple form that you file with the copyright office. It's $35 to register your copyright, and they deposit a copy of your work in the Library of Congress, and it's a public notice that you created it and that you own it. Secondly, if someone does infringe on your copyright, meaning someone does something with your work without your permission, it gives you the right to use the federal courts to sue them for it. Copyright's a creation of federal law, so you use federal courts to enforce your rights to protect your copyright. But anyway, the copyright, it lasts for your lifetime plus 70 years. If the copyright is created by a company or under a pseudonym or anonymously. I mean, a corporation doesn't have a lifespan like we do. A corporation can go on and on and on until it's dissolved. So they created a time limit for how long the life of a copyright if it's owned by a corporation, and that's 95 years. Similarly, if it's written under a pseudonym or anonymous, the life of the copyright is 95 years. I'll tell you quickly, one reason, those, that lifespan of a copyright may seem kind of arbitrary. It's really coincidentally tied to whenever Mickey Mouse, the copyright for Mickey Mouse is about to expire from the original Steamboat Willie, whatever film. Somehow the copyright law gets revised by Congress and there's an extension of the term of copyright. Now Mickey Mouse is about to come up again very soon. I had it in my notes, but I don't remember it offhand, but we'll see what happens. I think Mickey Mouse is pretty protected because so much of Disney's imagery is protected by trademark, because they sell things based with Mickey Mouse on it and all of their logos and everything. So I think it's going to be very hard to do anything for it to go into the public domain easily. But that's a fun fact about, well, fun for lawyers, about the length of copyright. When do you not own the rights to what you create? Well, one is if it's a work for hire. If you are by contract, two ways. If by contract someone commissions you to create something for them, and you have a written contract that says that you're doing it as a work for hire and that they will own it, the work product, they can take ownership in your work. Interesting thing about commissions, particularly as it affects theater professionals and playwrights, is that the work for hire terms don't really specifically talk about theatrical works. And obviously theaters commission works all the time. And generally the practice is that the playwright really kind of retains their rights unless you physically transfer and assign your copyright to the playwright. And there's a process and that has to be in writing. But in other areas, for example, sculptors, someone can commission you to create a piece of art for them, and they can transfer the copyright to that person. The other way in which you don't, something's a work for hire, is if you do it in the course of your employment. This is more applicable, for example, if you are cartoonist for Disney, and something that you create during the business hours with their resources at their direction will be owned by the Disney Corporation and not by the person who's doing it in the scope of their employment. Though what you do on your free time is your own. A couple other things about copyright. You can have people collaborate all the time and create joint works and collaborative works. You all have an equal ownership right in that work that you create, and all of you can give people sort of non-exclusive rights to do things with that work without permission of the other collaborators. However, you can't give someone the exclusive right to do something. If you and a friend write a play together, one of you cannot go and say to a producer, you can have the exclusive right to produce this play, without getting the consent to your collaborator, unless, and you should do this, you create a contract among yourselves where you agree up front how you're gonna handle that. You can by contract change this, so what happens by operation law. One thing I talked about, I just brought up licensing. As the owner of the copyright, there two ways you can give people the ability to do something with your work that you created. Most of the time you are licensing the right. And a license, it just means you're giving somebody else permission to do something with what you own. When I talk about contracts briefly, certainly any license that you give someone should be as narrow as possible. Any permission that you give to someone to do anything should be as narrow as possible to cover what they are going to do with it, but not necessarily giving them the universe of options that they may not, that you would have, you know, of options that they don't need, I'll say for now. Hollywood and Broadway treat written works, plays and screenplays are treated very differently. In the film world, producers tend to buy the scripts. Well, after a script that they decide that they're gonna go ahead and produce, they will buy the rights to that outright. The writer is not the original writer, unless they're a very powerful person, tends to not have very much say or control over what happens after that. That's why often there'll be a lot of other screenwriters brought in to do edits after the producer decides to exercise an option and take and buy a property. It kind of becomes theirs. Often with the original script that an actor may have been attracted to that was really brilliant, something very, very different by the time you start shooting it. And that's one reason why. Luckily for you, that in the theater world, at least the people who aren't producers, the people who write plays, is that the playwright is very, very powerful, just by practice, as well as by a mandate by the unions. The playwright tends to retain ownership of the play that they created. They have a lot of say as long as that play is protected by copyright, in terms of, no changes can really be made without their input. They often have a lot of input in terms of directors and casting and things like that. They don't transfer their rights, or sell their rights to the producer. They license. They just give the producer the right to produce and put on this production of their play under specific circumstances, in a particular theater, in a particular, et cetera. So that's a little difference between the film and theatrical worlds. We can go past that. Oh, why don't you go back? Go back one. Go back one. Let's go back to William Shakespeare. I'm going to skip over some other slides. That we have some things in here that are really very, very specific to writers that I'll go through. I'll just mention the slides as we go through them, and then we'll just move on because there's so much to cover. Last couple of things I'll say is that once the copyright for a work expires, it goes into the public domain, meaning anyone can do whatever they want with it. William Shakespeare is there on the slide because obviously it is well beyond his lifetime plus 70 years, even though the copyright laws were very different if they even existed back then. For example, I just at South by Southwest, there was a film of version of Romeo and Juliet where they made substantial changes to the text, and where it was done through social media, where there was a lot of communication. The whole film was through texts and selfies, and that's the way they shot the this particular version, and hashtags of Romeo and Juliet. So it was really innovative. It was a way to, and they could do that with complete license, not in the legal sense, but just with whatever they wanted to do because the work is in the public domain. There are times when you can use works that are protected by copyright without having to get the permission of the owner. This is again a little bit, it can affect producers as well, but I guess it really for playwrights, is it fair use? Works, criticism, comment, parodies that would apply to the theater professionals. news reporting, education, where you can, I will say, fair use, I won't go down the rabbit hole, but just to, for you to know that you should get advice before you want to use something that is protected by copyright. If you want to do a parody of a work that's protected by copyright, maybe get some advice to do that, because there is some room to do that. There's some room to mention or quote from other works, but it's a very muddy area of law. People think that there are rules. You can use one line, you can sing one line of a song. Those rules are completely subjective, and what would work in one line of a song in one context will be a violation of somebody's rights in another context. So you should really get advice. Okay, we can move forward. Next slide, I'm sorry. There are a few things, other things that will affect the content of a work. Often this is like in books and films, like publicity rights, privacy rights. This may, well, certainly for people, things based on someone's life, works based on someone's life, unauthorized biographies, documentaries, even plays based on someone's life. There are aspects, just so you know, of there is no real right to privacy, but there may be things that you would want to consider that and get advice on. Going back to publicity, because many of you are performers and some of you are very well-known performers. The one thing I will say about publicity rights is that the more well-known you become, the more rights you have and the less rights you have. As someone who is a public figure, there will be more license for people to take your photograph and things like that. However, someone cannot, there are boundaries in terms of how much people can violate your privacy. But I do want to say one thing to look out for before I go on to other things. If you could go back one slide. With publicity, I just want to mention, if you ever see your photo attached to a product or in an ad that you did not approve yourself, you have rights. I have Sarah Jessica Parker here because Sephora ran an ad, big company with lots of lawyers and lots of people, eyes who would have viewed this ad before it went out. They created an ad that featured her, but no one ever asked her permission. And she, because she makes a living based on her image, based on her, she controls that, and they can't use her image to endorse a product or their business without her permission. And she probably got a lot of money from them. But that was mine. But for me, as someone who has worked in a corporation and knows the number of eyes that look at those things, means that The Office is not a parody. The Office, the show, is not a parody. That it's just ridiculous. But going on in terms of the content of a work, you move forward. Next slide. Libel, slander, defamation, both in terms of the content of your work, but as well as just what is said or written about you as someone who may make their living performing for the public or presenting things to the public. You'll see that people will publish things that are absolutely untrue. Writers become very scared if they are doing something based on a real life as to whether or not that person, if they just don't like the way they're portrayed, can object. Certainly, truth is always a defense to any libel or slander or defamation lawsuit. And there has to be an intent to ill intent to damage someone's reputation. They have to say something false, and a certain opinion, though, is fairly protected. So writers and creators do have some leeway. But by the same token, if you are a public persona and someone says something that's outright untrue and just negligently untrue or maliciously untrue and damaging to you, you may have some rights to go after them. We can go forward. Now we'll skip over sort of censorship issues. So next, that however long that was, discussion of copyright. The reason why I did that is because an understanding of it, that's sort of the basis of all the contracts you enter into will all deal with how to slice those rights in the work and what permissions to give to whom and for how long and for and where and for how much. Those are generally what you're dealing with. And if you perform, you're performing in a creative work that's likely is or was protected by copyright. But contracts and business arrangements. Generally, I'm not really certain of the composition of everyone who attended. Some of you may be actors, some of you may be producers, you may be musicians, you may be composers, wide range of theater professionals. And of course, you're all affected by the contracts you enter into with the productions that you work on or create. Those contracts will be impacted by any union or guild that you belong to or don't belong to, and that places limitations on some of the things you do. But first, before I kind of go into, I'll just talk about contracts in general. From a legal perspective, what is a contract? It seems obvious, but sometimes you have to start by answering the obvious question. A contract is basically just a meeting of the minds between at least two parties, where one offers the other, I want to hire you to your services as an actor to perform in this production of Hamlet. Yes, I do want to perform in this production of Hamlet that you have offered me the opportunity to perform in. And then for what consideration? What are you going to be paid? And what are you going to be expected to do? That's the basis of a contract. And the meeting where the two of you meet, your minds meet in terms of what they want to give you and what you're willing to accept, that's the contract. And a contract can be written or verbal, though there are many types of contracts that have to be in writing. Most of the contracts that we're dealing with, that you would deal with in the theatrical production realm, have to be in writing. Certainly, a license of rights into a work protected by copyright has to be in writing. Any contract to perform any kind of service for more than a year has to be in writing. So we're really dealing with written contracts. There, outside of what we're talking about, there's probably instances where, for example, let's say you want to have some headshots taken, and you may not have some big formal written contract to do that, but there's some, you know, friend of a friend who they say is good, who's going to do these photographs, and they tell you, you know, it's going to cost X amount. You may not have a contract, but there's ways that you can sort of protect your understanding of what the arrangement is without having the contract, so that if for some reason, like my wedding photographer, you never get, you get the contact sheets, but you never get the actual photos, or they shoot them and maybe you give a deposit, and when they come back, they tell you, no, you have to pay an extra $500, not an extra $200 for me to turn it over to you. Those sorts of things, what I would suggest if you don't have a written contract, is that you start maybe an email exchange. Email's good because email's permanent. It's my just, you know, following up. Thank you for agreeing to take my headshots. Just confirming, you know, it'll be, you know, we'll do this on X date and I'll pay you X and it'll include X. You know, whatever your understanding is, just put it in the email, you know, the thank you email, and they will likely not contradict what you wrote. And they'll say, oh yeah, sure, I'll see you Thursday. But at least you have something in writing so that if you have to go to small claims court or Superior Court in New York or whatever to get those photographs from that person, to the extent that you can find them, you'll have something, you'll have some evidence that you can bring in to say, hey, this was our meeting of the minds. This was our sort of verbal contract, our verbal arrangement, and they reneged on it. So that's all I'll say about that. In the theater context, wow, there's so many different arrangements and contracts that you will face. If you're a producer, I mean, one of the first things you're going to do if there is a work that you want to produce, you have to get the rights to that work. And that's generally a rights agreement with the playwright, or if there's one of the agencies that handles licensing rights for that playwright, you might deal with them. Or you may be dealing with the playwright directly. And that's kind of a copyright, really. It's really a copyright license, basically, that rights agreement, where you'll talk about the scope of the rights. The playwright's giving you permission. They're giving you a license. They're giving you permission to use, to produce a production based on their play, the play that they wrote for a period of time. They're not selling you their right, their copyright. Is it exclusive or non-exclusive? It's probably exclusive to that producer for a period of time in whatever type of venue or location they're going to produce that play. The territory, what's the location of where they're going to produce the play, compensation, and royalties, as well as other approvals. I mean, a lot of these terms are covered by, for example, if the playwright is a member of the Dramatists Guild, a lot of these terms will be covered by that. And if they're particularly powerful, they may be able to have even broader rights than their union protects. The producer that will then go on to generally, you know, they hire a general manager. They will have to raise money to put on this production. And so there will be all kinds of contractual arrangements that relate to that. They'll have to form an entity. Well, this is going into, well, I'll talk about that in a minute. They will have contracts with co-producers. They will start hiring all of the different, the cast and the crew and all of the people that will work on the production. That those are all contracts. I will say the union, unions and guilds, if you are a member, for example, of Equity, of course, they will have certain contractual minimums for the production that you're involved in. I'm going to skip ahead for just a second. If you can go to the next slide. Yes. Because with a theatrical production, before all these contracts to hire people to work on the production are carried out, they'll have to figure out, is this a worthwhile endeavor? They will have to raise money in order to put on that production. And that relates to the formation of a business. I'll skip to the second part where we're talking about producers, not actors, forming their own company. But the producer will tend to form a production entity. Usually it's an LLC or a limited partnership. The reason why I jumped ahead is that I will tell you briefly what the different types of company forms that you can create and what they are and how they're different. And then I'll just tell you the ones that tend to be used in the theatrical context. So there are different various ways in which you can form a business. You can be just a sole proprietor. You don't have to actually form an entity. And you can just get a doing business as name and just do your business. There's downsides to that. A big downside is that you are fully liable personally for everything that happens with respect to that business activity. And so it's not just, and what forming an entity, certain types of entities will let you do is that the funds that are in the business are at risk, but your home and your personal resources may not be at risk. But if you're just doing business as a sole proprietor without forming a company, if your business venture goes south, you're fully liable personally, and you know they could come after your personal home, etc., for the expenses related to that failed business. So the next step, if it's more than just you, you could form a partnership. And one form of partnership is a general partnership. But in a general partnership, and you'd have an agreement between you and your partners. However, if you're both general partners, you're still all fully liable personally for any of the business activities that you carry out as part of that business. So another type of entity was created called a limited partnership. And a limited partnership, who is the person that's fully liable for anything that happens. But in order to raise money for the business, they'll bring on limited partners who are only liable up to what they invest in the partnership. These are all partnerships, though, are just a matter of pretty much signing an agreement with someone else. And there are other types of entities that have now been created where you do a filing with the state where you create your business. And because you do that, you have some additional protections. The next one would be an LLC, and a lot of you probably may be familiar with that already, either because you produce works through an LLC, or as an individual, you form an LLC for your craft. And an LLC is basically it's just sort of a mix between a limited partnership and a corporation. Like a limited partnership or a sole proprietorship, those entities, whatever you earn, your tax, it's part of your just personal income. And so you're only taxed once for whatever profits you make in the business. An LLC, even though it's a formal entity, you're only taxed, your personal income taxes, you're taxed for what you make, your portion of what you make out of the business. The entity itself is not taxed. It's called kind of a pass-through entity. However, unlike a partnership, you are fully protected personally against the liabilities of the business. So whatever's in the business is at risk, whatever you've invested in the business is at risk. But once those funds dry up, you're not personally at risk for the obligations of the business. So you kind of get the best of both worlds. You both get limited liability, as well as you get the favorable tax treatment where you're only taxed once. You're taxed on the income that you make out of the business, and you can deduct all of your business expenses because you've created this entity. So that's become a very popular form of entity. The one little downside of it is that at least in New York State, you have to, if you form an LLC, it's a very simple process, but it's basically filing. It's a very simple form that you file. However, articles of organization that you file, you have to publish those articles of organization in two publications for a period of time. And that it's kind of for a small business person or for a young actor who wants to form their own company, but it's just starting out. There is an expense to that to keep it published for, I think it's 6 weeks, in two sort of broader distribution publications. So that's for smaller productions or just for individuals starting out. That's a little bit of a downside, but there's lots of benefits to that type of entity. The next one would be a corporation. And I'm not going to deal with an S corp right now. That's sort of one thing that people use for personally. It's a tax treatment. I'll just talk about the regular corporation, which is called a C corporation. For those of you that would remember when Mitt Romney ran for president, he got into trouble for making a statement once that corporations are people too, my friends, something like that. I'm paraphrasing. We went to the same law school. So I probably listened to it, not at the same time, but a similar lecture where they told us that corporations, once you form a corporation, it's its own person for purposes of the law. It pays its own taxes. And then the owners of that corporation, meaning the shareholders, or they pay taxes on the income that they also pay taxes on the income that they get from the profits of that company. So there's sort of a double taxation. Both the company pays taxes as well as the owner pays on the profits that they take out of the business, unlike these other entities. A corporation can sign contracts and own property and all that kind of stuff. So that's what he meant by, that's actually what he meant by, no, I don't know. No, actually, I don't know what he meant. He may have meant that corporations are people too in the wrong kind of way. I think he did. But they are treated as, quote, people for purposes of the fact that they can do things that an individual can do. And the downside being for tax purposes, a traditional corporation, there are tax disadvantages. And again, with a corporation, the reason why people do them, one, they give you an ability to raise large amounts of money because then you can still sell shares in your company. So depending on what it is, if it's a software company or something like that, or a product where it's going to take a lot of resources to develop and manufacture and distribute that product, you're likely going to form a corporation because you can tap into much broader means of raising lots of money to do that by being able to sell shares in your company and raise money in different ways. And it's worth the extra taxes you pay. A corporation's shareholders are only liable for what happens in that corporation up to the point that they've invested. So if you invested $1,000 in a company and something happens, you're only liable up to that $1,000. There's of course a but to all of this. There are instances where things shady are going on where authorities will pierce through and go after the owners of a corporation. And that happened. That does happen. But just this, we're talking about the theory of it. So, which types of entities would you choose as an individual or as a to form a production company to do a production? You have all these choices. Most productions these days tend to be either limited partnerships or LLCs. LLC is a relatively newer form of entity than a limited partnership. You're seeing them more because everyone can be protected from liability. You don't have to have one general partner who's fully liable. And they offer a lot of flexibility, which is why you see them. One thing I will say, though, a lot of even if you form an LLC, once you form it, because you're going to put on your production and you start to raise money, there's a whole other legal construct that may affect how you raise money. And we're on the right slide. Down below, where is it? Fundraising, private placements, crowdfunding. There are both federal laws and state laws that exist to protect investors who aren't considered sort of sophisticated investors or accredited investors. The reason why these laws came about really came from like after the stock market crashed in 1929, and where a lot of people lost a lot of money. And then you also had like lots of snake oil salesmen, literally snake oil salesmen. I guess we still have them. Where people could easily dupe people into investing in things that weren't worthwhile. So in order to raise certain amounts of money, and I won't go through all the rules, I'm just telling you that they exist, so that if you go about doing this, you'll have the sort of you'll get the sort of counsel that can guide you through it. But where you have to, there may be restrictions on the number of people where most of your investors may have to, if they're not, I'll rephrase how I said it. There's a limitation on the number of investors who don't have a certain net worth or a certain amount of income level. Because if they say, well, if people make a certain amount per year or have a certain net worth, those tend to be people who are going to be able to assume more risk than someone who may lose everything if they invest in something. Someone tells them, oh, this is going to be the next, Hamilton. You got to invest in this. And they may not know any better, and they invest their life savings and then they lose it. They may not understand how easy it is, what's involved in putting on a production and how expensive it is and how hit or miss. Not every even huge Broadway production that people spend a lot of money and time and effort putting on. Some of them may close within a week. And there are rules that try to make sure that people are know what they're getting into, that they're advised. So there are certain filings that you'll have to make. There will be certain acknowledgments where people will acknowledge that they understand the risks involved, as well as limitations on your ability to attract investments from people below a certain amount. That one thing that there's a lot of people, especially for smaller productions and things, are doing crowdfunding these days. And that's the question arises, well, how can you do that? If there's so many restrictions on, in terms of, or you have to be very careful in raising money, large sums of money from people, how can people do crowdfunding and just have anybody give you money? Well, in the crowdfunding source, what you're doing is you're not selling an interest in the production, or like an ownership interest in the production, or an ownership interest in the company that puts on the production. What you're doing is you're telling people, I'm trying to get this thing off the ground, and you don't own part of it, but if you want to help me do it, you can give me money. Of course, you have to be truthful in what you're doing, but it's they're not buying an ownership interest. And crowdfunding tends to be, people can give whatever, people are giving much smaller amounts of money, but they add up. And then there's certainly the friends and family route and other routes that people take to raise money. But just so you know, that in terms of fundraising, depending on the size of the production, there's quite a bit that will go into attracting investors, the types of agreements that you have to enter into, as well as the notifications to public authorities that you will, in both state and federal, that you will have to be aware of and comply with, and that you'll get a production attorney that will be able to guide you through that. So now that we've gone through all of that, once you do have a production entity and you are stuck, well, you know, I'll skip ahead. We've talked generally about that. I'm going to briefly, so that we can start asking questions and you can tell me what you'd like to hear. excuse me, just a few things that your mom would tell you if she was a lawyer. She would tell you, because she's naturally skeptical, to avoid agents, managers, casting directors, et cetera, who charge you an upfront fee. There are, of course, exceptions to that. But I'll give you an example. Someone who you go in because you want to be cast in something, and they're really just trying to sell you headshots, or they're trying to get you to take tons of acting lessons. That may not be legit. Also, your mom would tell you, you know, Google exists now. You can look up, you can at least try to look up some of the people involved. You can look up the entities involved. You can contact, you know, go to the Better Business Bureau's website to see if there have been any complaints against them. You know, try and do some due diligence on anybody that you work with. Certainly, some of the guilds have, I think SAG-AFTRA has a list of their sort of franchised agents, which at least will give you a clue of some of the good agents out there. Last few things I'll say, you know, do your math homework in terms of, try to pay attention to the numbers review the people who are managing your money are doing and telling you. If you don't see it or can't get cast in it, create it. And sometimes, you know, songwriters always get paid, or they should at least. Whereas if you're waiting for that royalty check, it may or may not come just by performing a song. Sometimes you have to pay a publicist. Your Instagram fee may not be enough. If you can't get anything else, get your own hair and makeup person if you can. You know, hair, makeup, wardrobe, you know, you want to appear your best. Well, I'm going to stop talking for now because I could go on and on. I'd like to introduce one of BTU's founding members, Vanessa Williams.
Thank you, Ginger. Hair and makeup, learn how to do it. That's for sure.
Exactly.
Be resourceful with your wardrobe because, yes, you have to. It's about appearances and first impressions. So that's definitely something that my mother always, always told me. And of course, as a theater person, you learn how to put on your face and do your hair and get ready for those auditions, but also to do your role in each show. So thank you. It was so, so informative. So much to unpack there, but I want to start with one question. So if you don't have a lawyer, can you send yourself a letter that contains your idea in the mail and never open it? Will the postmark serve as a proof as the date of when you had the idea? This is it used to be called the poor man's copyright. Yep. Does this provide any legal cover at all?
Well, what it does, all of these things make you feel, I'm so glad you asked that question because I usually say it in my, when I talk to writers. People used to do that because the copyright law is a little different. It doesn't give you any additional rights. Your right comes from creating the work, being the author of the work. What it does do, it does provide, and that's why I tell people to register their copyright as well, but it does provide you with some, just another piece of evidence, kind of like that email to the photographer, mm-hmm. that, hey, I really did. And if it's an idea, Well, I guess if you've written it down, if you've written something down that you can send to yourself, then you might have something protected by copyright. But if you were just said, hey, I wrote out this whole story outline or this rough draft, and you send it to yourself, and I did it this at this point, it does create a link in the chain of information and proof such that if you ever had to go and defend that you were the author, if someone steals it, you can say, yeah, and I can prove I wrote it when I said I did.
Exactly. Okay. Another question. It's regarding privacy. If I post my thoughts or musings on social media and someone then uses my words in a film or television or stage production, do I have the rights or is everything on social media fair game? That's the world in which we live in now.
There's layers to that. Because in terms of something that you said, if they're quoting you and they attribute those words to you and you actually said them, it's not necessarily something that's, it's not protected by copyright, just like a statement that you make, it's not necessarily copyrightable. So they, depending on the context, they may be able to quote you. To the extent they use it commercially and attribute, and put your name on it commercially, and are they going to put it on a t-shirt and sell that? That's when you're getting into, well, are they using something that comes from me that I don't want them to? But I think social media, and it's actually a big category that I just didn't even touch, but I started to delve into it with writers because there's so many layers to a lot of what we do on social media. It's not that it's not copyright infringement. It's just that in the world we live in, people who create things permit a lot of sharing these days for good reasons, to bring their work to more people. You use it as a vehicle, and there are other people so that they will come to you to explore your work. But that's from the way you described it, if they might be able to, unless it's they're commercializing it.
Right.
In some way.
Okay. One more question. We've heard about stories about people, by 14 people that are writing something. Can an artist protect their work and refuse others from taking credit and royalties? I mean, if there's a song and there's 14 people that are contributing.
Generally, I might need to know a little bit more in terms of how they're contributing, because often a songwriter will write a song, or there may be, in terms of how it's arranged and performed and contributions and that kind of, like with stage direction, for the most part, that's not, and those presentations doesn't give that person rights. Kind of like my editor doesn't have, who may make concrete suggestions and things like that, doesn't gain an ownership interest in the work that I created. If a work is completely collaborative and being created like in a room and you're all throwing things around, that's a little muddier. that's a lot muddier, where you're sort of creating it from scratch. I would say that depending on the contribution, some of those people, if it's all being done together, you all may be co-creating something. Right. And you might want to talk about it. Don't just go out and put your name on it and copyright it. You may just sit down and talk about how you're gonna deal with it.
Our next question is going to pop up on screen. It's from someone who's watching, and we can read it together. And yep. I will wait till it comes up. And if I don't see it in 1 minute, then I'm going to go to my next question. I don't see it. Town hall, minding your, okay. Let me jump to this next question. Oh, here we go. Okay. Candy Dugas. Hi, thank you for this. are copyrighted and trademarked works protected globally?
That's a great question. The way in which they're protected globally is through treaties. That's one of the things that treaties actually, you know, government at work, what treaties actually do. There are international treaties on copyright, patent, and trademark protection that most countries are signatories to, even some of the biggest violators like mm-hmm. China and Russia. However, enforcement is still an issue, but if you have a protected a work that's protected by copyright in one country, pretty much just about every other country in the world is going to be a signatory to those international treaties, and you should be protected. You are protected in those other countries and can enforce your rights there.
Great. Next question from Michael Friedlander. Can you talk about the difference between being contracted as a employee versus an independent contractor?
I'm so glad that you brought that up because I completely glossed over it because I was trying to encamp, you know, shorten my presentation. Yes. In terms of how you're treated for tax purposes, or just in general, like if you're most people who are hired on a production will be independent contractors. You'll have a 1099 and you will pay your own taxes. If you are an employee, you'll have a W-2. How they make that it's interesting, the determination that the IRS will go through, all of the factors that they'll go through is, are you an independent contractor or are you an employee? Are the same as the ones that the copyright law would look at to see if you did something for as a work for hire or as an employee. Certainly in the creative context, you didn't say the context. If you are working on something and you get a W-2, you're definitely an employee. If you don't receive a W-2, they are likely treating you as an independent contractor. And certainly, if you're an independent contractor, what you create, you actually own. Mm-hmm. And if you are an employee, it will be owned by your employer when you create it. I don't know if that's helpful, but those would be the some of the differences. There's a tax difference as well as a difference in terms of who the copyright designates as the owner of what's created, depending on the two.
Great.
I hope that helps.
Okay. I have one more question, and it is, can an artist contractually request gender parity or an inclusion rider to ensure that any project they work on reflects their values?
You can contract anything that they're willing to sign. Mm-hmm. Having the, you know, certain actors have more leverage than others. And if where you'd be able to demand that. But certainly if they are willing to agree to it, you can put that in a contract. In practical terms, it may be hard to actually define those things if they're more subjective. Mm-hmm. Certainly, gender parity, if it's an exact same role on a production, they should be paid. And you say those two actors should be paid the same, or those two professionals should be paid the same. That seems pretty simple, in the execution, it might get a little muddy, but
right.
Yeah. Anything they're willing to agree to that's not illegal, you can build a contract around it.
Well, you're brilliant. Thank you so much for joining us here at BTU tonight. It's wonderful to get your side and get into your brain to learn about the business. So Ginger McKnight-Chavers, thank you for taking your time. I know your schedule is demanding, and you educated us all and inspired us all. So we are so grateful for you for sharing your time and your expertise. I also want to thank our certified ASL interpreters, Andrea Lust and April Jackson Woodward. You've been phenomenal. Thank you so much. I want to thank our stage manager, Edmund O'Neill, Angela Johnson, Katura Lee, and a special thanks to David Katz for donating his time to our technical direction for this evening. And I want to thank everyone who has donated to our website. Every donation helps us to keep this work going, and we truly appreciate everything you do. If you have not done so already, please visit our website, blacktheaterunited.com. That's theater with an R-E. And for helping us with our ongoing initiatives, and join the movement to make our industry better. We love hearing from you. And of course, I can't leave tonight without introducing our anthem, which is called Stand for Change. We've got a video out on YouTube so you can enjoy it. You can also download the music on all streaming platforms. But Stand for Change is all about the work that we're doing, that we continue to do, and we're standing up for change. So thank you, everyone, for joining us tonight. Thank you, and good night. Here's Stand for Change.
You cannot be afraid to speak up and speak out for what you believe. You have to have courage. Raw courage.
Stand for Change.
Nothing can be changed until it is faced.